Hey everybody, I want to get back to basics. I want to get back to doing math with you all in a relaxed environment where I emphasize really three main things: exploration, discovery, and joy. With this video, it's a first in a series of what I hope will be hundreds of videos where we explore complex numbers and complex analysis. I think it's the most beautiful math subject that there is. I'd like to encourage comments, and I'll try to respond to those that are commenting in the first day. I'd also like to encourage you to respond to each other's comments and build community. If you like this content, I'd also ask that you please consider liking, subscribing, and sharing this video. So let's start exploring the basics of complex analysis. In this video, what I'd like to focus on is the following question. What is the most interesting basic thing to know about the imaginary unit I? The imaginary unit I is defined by the condition that I squared equals negative 1. Now, the first question I typically get from students is, how do I know such a number exists? After all, if I take any ordinary real number and square it, I don't get a negative number. So how do we know this exists? My answer is that we define it to exist. We define I by this condition, and we also generalize to complex numbers, and we define what it means to add, subtract, multiply, and divide them. The only questions after that point are threefold. First, do they form a consistent number system? Secondly, are they interesting? And thirdly, are they useful? The answer to all three of those questions are yes, yes, and yes. And that's something that we'll explore here in future videos. But for the moment, let's just explore what this condition would mean if we want the usual rules of algebra to still hold. And in particular, what would it mean to raise I to other integer powers, like I cubed, I to the fourth power, I to the fifth power, etc. Also I to the zero power, and even negative powers as well. I to the negative 1, I to the negative 2, I to the negative 3, etc. Again, keep in mind that we want the usual rules of algebra to hold. So what should I cubed be if we want the usual rules of algebra to hold? Well, 3 is 2 plus 1. So I can write 3, that exponent, as 2 plus 1. And if I want the usual rules of algebra to hold, this should be the same as I squared times I to the first. I to the first, as with any old and other number, should be I. So this should be the same as I squared times I. And we know I squared is defined by the condition that it equals negative 1. So this is a negative 1. We get negative 1 times I. That equals negative I. If we want the usual rules of algebra to hold, I cubed should equal negative I. What about I to the fourth power? I can think of 4 either as 2 plus 2 or 3 plus 1. Let's see if thinking of it either way gives us the same answer for what I to the fourth should be in the end. I to the 2 plus 2, if we want the usual rules of algebra to hold, should be I squared times I squared. But again, I squared is defined by the condition that it equals negative 1, so this is negative 1 times negative 1. But we know negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. I to the 4th is positive 1. What if we thought of it as I to the 3 plus 1 power? Then that should be I cubed times I to the 1st. I cubed we found up here to be negative I. This is negative I times I. I can factor that negative sign out and get this. That's the same as negative times the quantity I squared. Negative 1 times the quantity I squared. Negative of negative 1 is positive 1. We are getting the exact same answer here, positive 1, whether we think of that exponent 4 as either 2 plus 2 or as 3 plus 1. Let's keep going. How about we use a different color too? How about I to the fifth power? Well, that should be I to the 3 plus 2 power for one thing, or I to the 4 plus 1. Let's see if both of those give the same answer. By rules of exponents, that should be the same as I to the third power times I squared. We found I to the third power to be negative I. We know I squared is negative 1. Factor out both of those negative signs as negative 1s like this. Negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. Times I times 1 evidently should be I. I to the fifth should be I. Interesting. We're back to where we started with the imaginary unit I. If we think of I to the fifth as I to the 4 plus 1, do we get the same answer? That's the same as I to the fourth times I to the first. I to the fourth we found up here to be positive 1, and I to the first should be I. This is giving us I. These match as well. Interesting, we got back to I. That's pretty amazing and perhaps unexpected if you didn't know this ahead of time. Let's try a couple more positive powers. How about I to the sixth? We could think of that as I to the 3 plus 3, or if you like, I cubed squared. I cubed we found to be negative I, so this should be negative I squared, negative I times negative I. Two negative signs can be factored out to give us this. That's positive 1, this is negative 1. It looks like the answer should be negative 1. Yeah, that kind of makes sense. I to the 5th was I to the 6th should be effectively I squared, which is negative 1. How about I to the 7th? That should be I to the 4th times I cubed. I to the 4th was positive 1. I to the 7th is I cubed. I bet I to the 8th is I to the 4th, which is positive 1. Yeah, we could even think about it this way. We can think about it as positive 1 squared, which is positive 1. These numbers are cycling. In fact, they form something called a cyclic group. I'll let you look that up. How about other integer powers of I? What should I to the 0 power be? Well, effectively, just like I to the 1st, by definition, we would want to be I, just like with any number to the 1st power. Also, with I to the 0 power, we should effectively want this to be positive 1. Since any number to the 0 power is 1, except 0 to the 0 power can be other things. It's what's called an indeterminate form. If we want the rules of algebra to hold, this should be true. We're going to see that this also forms a nice pattern geometrically here in a few minutes. What about negative powers of I? Like I to the negative 1, what should that be? I'll just put a question mark here initially. Well, what in general, what does it mean when you raise a non-zero number to the negative 1 power? It means you're after what's called its multiplicative inverse, the thing to multiply it by to get positive 1, the multiplicative identity. What do we need to multiply I by to get positive 1? We know when we multiply I by itself, we get negative 1. I times negative I, therefore, should be positive 1. We can factor the negative sign out in front as a negative 1 and write this as negative 1 times I squared. This is negative 1. Negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. This means that I to the negative 1 power is, in fact, that thing right there. It is negative I. Amazing. I is a number whose multiplicative inverse is also its additive inverse. Let that sink in. Pretty profound. What about I to the negative 2 power? Negative 2 could be thought of as negative 1 plus negative 1. Using rules of exponents, this should be I to the negative 1 times I to the negative 1, if we want the rules of exponents to hold. We just found that I to the negative 1 power is negative I, so this is negative I times itself. Those two negative signs can be factored out in front, like this. That's positive 1, so we get positive 1 times I squared, negative 1. I to the negative 2 power is negative 1, just like I squared is negative 1. Interesting. How about I to the negative 3 power? Think of it as I to the negative 2 minus 1, or plus negative 1. That's the same as I to the negative 2 times I to the negative 1. We just found I to the negative 2 is negative 1, and I to the negative 1 is negative I. Bring the two negative signs out in front like usual, and we have this right here. Negative 1 times itself is positive 1. That's a positive 1. 1 times 1 times I is I. How about that? I to the negative 3 is I. I to the negative 4. We could think of that as I to the negative 2 quantity squared if we wanted to. I to the negative 2 is negative 1. This is negative 1 squared. Negative 1 times itself, that's positive 1. I bet I to the negative 5 is the same as I to the negative 1. I bet I to the negative 5 is negative I. Let's give it a try. I to the negative 5 is going to be I to the negative 4 times I to the negative 1. I to the negative 4 we just found to be positive 1. I to the negative 1 we found to be negative I. Yes, this is negative I. What's interesting to do now is to put all this information together in a picture. A picture in something called the complex plane. A plane where the horizontal axis is labeled with the word real, or RE for short, and the vertical axis is labeled with the word imaginary, or IM for short, and we plot all real numbers on the real axis, with zero being right there, positive numbers over here, negative numbers over here. We plot all purely imaginary numbers along this vertical imaginary axis. I'm calling it an imaginary axis, but it is there. I drew it. You can see it. Okay? It's just as real as the real axis. I, for example, will be up here. Negative I will be down here. If we start with I and raise it to higher and higher powers, we effectively go around the diagram like this. I squared is negative 1. That would be right here. I to the third is negative I. I to the fourth is back to positive 1. I to the fifth is back to I. I to the sixth is back to negative 1. This is I to the second. It's also I to the sixth. I to the seventh is down to negative I. This is I to the third and also I to the seventh. And I to the eighth power is back to 1. 1 is the same as I to the fourth and I to the eighth. We keep going around counterclockwise by 90 degrees every time the power of I keeps going up by 1. Conversely, we keep going around clockwise every time the power of I goes down by 1. 1 is I to the 0. Negative I is the same as I to the negative 1. Negative 1 is the same as I to the negative 2. I, which is the same as I to the 5th, is also the same as I to the negative 3. 1 was I to the 0, but it's also I to the negative 4. My diagram's getting kind of complicated looking here. This is I to the negative 5, I to the negative 6, I to the negative 7, I to the negative 8, etc. In fact, these numbers also stay on the unit circle in the complex plane, a circle of radius 1 centered at the origin. And let me end the video by showing you a Mathematica demonstration of this. Mathematica is one of my favorite computer programs to use. If you don't have Mathematica, you can still appreciate the output. If you do have Mathematica, this is the code that I'm using. You can, you know, take a screenshot of this or something so you can use it yourself. I'm going to show you what this code produces. Essentially, a nice visual of what I just showed you, where n here is the power of I. We can see we're starting out with I to the first equals I right there. I can increase n, and it rotates it counterclockwise so that I squared is negative 1. I cubed is negative I. I to the fourth is back to positive 1. I to the fifth is back to I. I to the sixth is back to negative 1, etc. I can keep going counterclockwise by 90 degrees each time the power of I goes up by 1. I can also consider negative powers, or a power of 0 right there. That's I to the 0 is 1. I to the negative 1 is negative I. I to the negative 2 is negative 1. I to the negative 3 is I. I to the negative 4 is back to positive 1, etc. This is pointing at something that is one of the most important parts of complex analysis, in that anytime you multiply an arbitrary complex number that has a non-zero real part, perhaps, and a non-zero imaginary part in this complex plane, anytime you multiply such a number by I, it rotates that number in that plane by a counterclockwise rotation of 90 degrees. That is an amazing fact, and it's really essential to making complex analysis work. Let me just end this video by saying I'm making these videos in honor of my dad, who passed away about 15 years ago. And what my dad, who had the same name as me, Bill Kinney, always said is strength and honor. Be strong, but also honor all people. You could say it's really a version of the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's it for this video. Have a good day.